Welcome to the Wednesday Word, a virtual Bible study. Stay tuned for some midweek motivation.
Good evening, everybody, and welcome to the Word on Wednesday, our midweek virtual Bible study. Thank you all for joining us. Thank you all for stopping by the Metropolitan Baptist Church virtually. Thank you so much for your continued support in your presence and also in your support of this ministry. We wouldn't be able to continue to do what we do without your love and your support and your prayers. This evening, man, I wish we could be together where I could feel your energy, feel your vibe. We could feed off each other, have an interactive session to really have some deep discussion about what's going on in our world, where God is in the midst of all of it, what God is up to and what he's doing. And I have to admit to you all, I have some indifferent feelings, in essence, I will say that I am overall encouraged. Like many of you are, I have my moments because I just cannot unsee George Floyd and what happened to our beloved brother. I just cannot unsee that. I think that is an image that will stick with all of us for the rest of our lives. Those of us who have the opportunity to live during the times that we're living in now, with the pandemic that's going on and with the uprising in our world, not just in these United States, but all over the world. I think this is different because we just cannot unsee the injustice that happened to our brother at the hands of someone that was supposed to be taking care of us and protecting and serving community. I know some may have probably checked out by now. Some may have moved on with their lives or desire to move on with their lives and really may not want to hear a lot more about this, that maybe some are saying it's time to move on. But I think that mentality and that mindset is what really keeps us from moving forward and keeps us with the momentum that we need to impact and have the change that we truly need in this country. Please don't trip. Don't get it twisted. We are seeing that it can absolutely happen to anyone. Although it happens to blacks and African Americans more at a frequent pace, we are seeing now 75 plus year old white men being treated by police and law enforcement in an aggressive and negative way. Am I saying that we don't need law enforcement? By no means am I saying that we don't need a legal system and a justice system. But what I am saying and what we are seeing is that we need a system that works for everyone. So the challenge for us on this Word on Wednesday, as we watch George Floyd be laid to rest on yesterday, the challenge for us is how do we continue to do this work that is necessary to, in essence, bring about the change that all of us that we're finding from all walks of life, all creeds, all colors, all nationalities, all countries are coming together to say that there needs to be a change throughout this entire world. How do we keep this work going? Because as people, and definitely sometimes as Americans and living here in America, we have very short memories. We move past things too quickly. And I think sometimes the enemy just kind of lays low and waits for us to just move on, lose the momentum, lose the energy, lose the commitment to the cause because it becomes so much like heavy lifting. It becomes so much work. And let's not make any bones about it. There will be some heavy lifting that needs to take place. It will be work that needs to happen for an extended period of time. This is not, beloved, this is not a sprint. This is a marathon. In marathons, you have to run the race very deliberately. You have to run the race very carefully, very methodically, and very strategically so that you have enough energy to finish the race. So I tried the best that I could to let our friend Nehemiah go, but I just couldn't let it go. The scripture was still talking from Sunday as the Lord spoke to us on Sunday about let's rise up, don't back down. A really challenging sermon, a teaching sermon delivered by God that pushes us and helps us hopefully to understand things a lot better and to put some things in perspective. Rise up. Don't back down. And Nehemiah is still talking on this Wednesday night. That is the beauty of scripture, that there's always more. That's the beauty of revelation and studying God's word. There's always more to the text, and we don't always have enough time to deal with the text during the worship experience on Sunday mornings or whatever, the entire text. But tonight I want to deal with verse 10 of the text in chapter 4, because the subject tonight is, you know, how do we keep the work going? How do we continue this work? How do we continue the energy and effort and keep the commitment behind this work to make things and bring about the change that we need? And verse 10 reads this way. It says, then the people of Judah, they began to complain. The workers are getting tired, the people are saying, and there is so much rubble to be moved. We will never be able to build the wall by ourselves. You all know the background and the backdrop of Nehemiah. He was the cupbearer for the king. He was an exile in Babylon. And Nehemiah had risen to a level of authority and influence in the enemy's camp. But he used that level of authority and influence to bring about some change. And as I shared on Sunday, when God promotes you, when God puts you in position, God doesn't do that just for you. He does that so you can effectively use that power and influence to bring him glory and to help draw men and women, boys and girls unto him. God has not placed you in that position of power just for you to be over somebody. God is not pushing you to that promotion that you don't want to take. Can I talk to somebody directly? That somebody's in a position right now for a promotion, but you're saying to yourself, no, I don't want to do that. I don't need the headache. I don't need the frustration. I don't need the pain. I don't need to be looked at as somebody that's on somebody else's team. I don't want to be in leadership. I don't want to be in management. But sometimes you have to take the position not just for you, but to get in a place of authority so that you can help some other people along. Because you when you get into a place of authority, into a decision-making role, you can effectively create diversity in situations where some others may not understand those that just are trying to get a hand up and not a hand out. He got to a place of authority. He uses his authority. He goes to the king. He looks over at the wall in Jerusalem. Some of the Jews have gone back. They've taken care of their own houses and rebuilding their own houses. But Nehemiah looks back over and sees the wall that's torn down. He sees the work of God that's not going forward. And he goes to the king and asks for permission. And lo and behold, king grants permission. And not only does he grant him permission, but he gives him the resources necessary to start the work. So the question becomes, what do we learn from Nehemiah tonight? What do we learn about how do we keep this work going? Well, one of the first things that you will find out and you'll discover as you study this scripture, as you study this book, is before Nehemiah did anything, even before he went to the king, Nehemiah started to pray. I told y'all on Sunday that prayer is the absolute foundation. Prayer is absolutely essential to the evolution of your life. Prayer is what keeps you steadfast and unmovable. And prayer, as I always teach, is not designed to change God. Prayer is designed that it changes us. Prayer does not change things. And I know you may have heard that for many years in churches. You may hear people say it over and over over again. Prayer does not change things all the time. Prayer is designed to change us. You got to get that. You got to take that with you the rest of your life. Prayer changes not God's posture, but it changes your posture. It changes your approach. It gives you the ability to deal with what you need to deal with. And Nehemiah starts off with prayer. Beloved of God, whatever you do, you got to start whatever work, you got to engage in whatever it is. You got to make sure that you have a talk with the Lord before you do anything. And I told our folks on Tuesday call that I pray a simple prayer every day, every morning. And my prayer is this: Lord, strengthen me and order my steps. It's just that simple. It doesn't take a long time, but a part of my prayer is, Lord, strengthen me and make sure that you order your steps. Asking that from God, for God's strength, means that I don't have to operate in my strength, because my strength gives out. My strength is finite, it's not infinite. But if I operate in God's strength, and God is truly strengthening me and undergirding me, then I will be able to do more than what I ever imagined in my life. I wish I had a witness that would testify that when you handed it over to the Lord, that God did more with it in his hands than what you ever did with it in your hands. Then I ask God to order my steps. That means that I don't want to walk in my own ways. I want to walk in God's way. I want God's ways. I want God to direct my path. I want to be where God is. I don't want God to join me in the work that I'm doing. I want to be able to see where God is working, and I want to join God wherever God is working. And here's the trouble with that, beloved, is sometimes there's a disconnect between where God is working and where you see yourself working, and you have to struggle and fight through not operating where you want to operate and join God in the work that he's facilitating in your life. You got to walk through the doors that God opens up. You got to go to the places that God gives you access to. And sometimes we're just trying to force the issue. Sometimes we're just trying to beat our way into certain places. Look, if it may not be easy, right? It may not be easy in your life. It may not be easy to walk where God wants you to walk sometimes, but if God is in it, there is no limit to what God will allow you to do. Strengthen me, God, and order my steps. Nehemiah prayed. That was his first order of business. And I told y'all on Sunday that he also, when he got here and he ran into some opposition, he ran into some problems, he did his best. He went and he prayed even more. We should pray often, we should pray early, and we should pray consistently. He prays again as his enemies come up against him. And we got to know, we have to know and not be shocked as we move through this period of change in our world and in our lives, that the enemy is coming. The enemy is going to regroup, and he's going to come back, and he's going to come back with a new strategy. He's going to come back in a different way. But that's okay if you're prayed up, if you've done the prayer work. But also we have to understand that there's some posting that's involved. Bible says that Nehemiah posted a guard on the wall and at the bottom portion of the wall. Nehemiah didn't want any trouble. And that's what some folk have to understand about black people and brown people. And even those that are marching, we see all walks of life that's doing the doggone thing with us. We see so much diversity that's so encouraging, that people really don't want trouble. They don't want violence. But at some point, you have to be able to say, you know what? If that is what it takes, I got to go to that level. Because it is interesting. It's so interesting that quickly the violence gets pointed out on black and brown people's side, but we never point out the violence that's in front of us, where a police officer basically kills an innocent man right in front of our eyes. It's amazing how we can point out violence in other people's camps, in black and brown people's communities, and see where the violence exists for the uprising that is taking place, but we never see the two white men that hunted down Ahmaud Arbery in a violent way. We don't call that out. It's a double standard. But you know what? We're not worried about that. But we're going to post up if necessary. We will post the guards at the bottom of the wall. We'll put guards on the top of the wall. We're going to keep doing work. But sometimes you got to do more than one thing at a time. To do this work, you got to pray. You have to post. But watch what else Nehemiah did. He assembled the people. He organized the people. The Bible says that their strength started to give out. When Nehemiah undertook this journey, this mission, this calling, this challenge from God, he didn't try to do it by himself. He invoked the presence of other people to help him. Can I pause right there and help somebody on this evening and tell you that in life you're going to need some people in your camp. You're going to need a team. You're going to need some folk that you can depend on, some people that you can call on, some people that's got your back, and some people that want to do the work. You cannot do this by yourself. We as black and brown people cannot do this by ourselves. We need the help of other people to make sure that we have aligned ourselves with some people that have the same interest that we do. Not everybody that's on the front line has the same issue. Not everybody that's on the front line has the same agendas. But when we assemble a team of people, a praying people, a God-fearing people that really want change to come about in this country, in this world, there's nothing that people can do with the masses and the numbers. And I just believe that most people want peace. Most people want to live together in harmony. Racism is real, y'all. Privilege is real, y'all. If you have not noticed, God has shown us something tremendously. He's shown us, follow me now, hear me now. He's shown us that it does not matter if you are a bird-watching Harvard graduate or you are a George Floyd with possibly no degree, that the enemy does not discriminate. Racism doesn't care, because education and affluence does not insulate or isolate you from the racism and the hatred that exists in this world. I know many don't like to hear that type of talk. Many don't want to hear black and brown. They don't want to hear white and Asian and Hispanic. But time is out for us being in a posture where we can't have honest conversation. He assembled the people, and we welcome all walks of life, all colors, all creeds, to get involved in this movement that God is effectively bringing about in this world. If you stand for righteousness, if you stand for what's right and what's good, and look, none of us are right all the time. None of us make the right decisions all the time. We will make some mistakes along the way. All of us will. We will get it wrong. And hopefully over time, you become more educated. You become more aware, more woke of the ills that has been perpetuated against black and brown people, against those that have been marginalized and criticized and put down. And if you stand for righteousness, you got to come along and become a part of this movement. He assembled the people. It's going to take more than just black and brown people. It's going to take some time to rebuild and to even start to build anew the structure and the foundation and the support that's needed to make this world a better place. Nehemiah had a heavy task ahead of him. But watch this. The only reason that Nehemiah is doing what he's doing is because he had a heart that he cared. And at some point, you have to care more about, you can't just care about yourself. You have to care for something more than just yourself. We can't be selfish where we're just looking to get our bag and we're just looking to make sure that our family is okay, that all of our needs are met. No, at some point, you got to care about other people, because the Bible says if you care about the least of them, if you've done it unto the least of them, you've done it unto me. We had he prayed. He brought the people together. He was willing to post up if necessary. And you know what number four is? The first people, watch this when you study the book of Nehemiah. As he assembled the people, watch this. The first people that signed up were the priests. Mm-hmm. The first people that signed up were the priest. What does that teach us? That those of us, me included, those of us who God has called to carry this gospel and to carry this mantle of servitude, to stand behind the sacred desk, who God has privileged, those of us who God has privileged to lead his flock and to care for his people, that we have to be the ones to go first. Reverend Al Sharpton came hard on yesterday during the eulogy, and he didn't miss words. And he said, this is what he said. He said that there's a bunch of holy punks in the pulpit, and we don't need no more holy punks in the pulpit. Some people gonna get alarmed by that comment, but this is what Reverend Sharpton was saying, that how in the world can we be called to God's work and we be afraid to do God's work? How in the world can we be called to lead his flock and we are scared shepherds? We're scared to talk and have a broadcast like this. We're afraid to put this out in social media because we don't want to offend anybody. We don't want anybody to twist our words or for anything to be misconstrued. But at the end of the day, God has called us to be courageous. He's called us to be fearless. He's called us to be fearless. He's called us to stand up, and he has called the church to go first. We should be leading the way when it comes to change. We should be leading the way. Our voices should be in the forefront. We should be on the megaphones, leading the people to a better place, to a higher place, that the priest went first. If we are going to continue this work, we got to pray. We got to post. We got to make sure, beloved of God, that we get the people, but the priests, the holy folk, the pastors, the elders, the bishops, the apostles, the chief apostles, we gotta go first. We cannot sit in a place of comfort and never speak out and never take the risk that God is calling us to take. Yes, it's a risk. Yes, it could cost you something. Yes, it cost Dr. King his life. Yes, it cost Malcolm X his life. But I found Grandma always told me, if you don't stand for something, son, you will fall for anything. The question tonight is, what are we going to stand for? What are we going to tolerate as a church, as a body of believers? What work are we going to do as the priests, as the shepherds, as the under shepherds of God's people, that God has called us to be the example? God has called us not to worry so much about the suits that we put on, but the service that we render. God has calling us not to be so worked up about our socks, but to be trying to make sure that we save some souls. God has called us not to make sure that we got on the tightest tie, but because we are able to help some people get to the next level. That is our responsibility as clergy, as ministers, as pastors, as lay people, those that are called Christians. God wants us to go first. We have to lead the world, but it seems like the world is leading us, that we're jumping on the bandwagon after the fact, and time out for playing safe. Time out for sitting on the sideline. I don't know about you, but I played competitive sports most of my life, on the schoolyard and in the schoolhouse. And that was one thing that I never liked. It was one thing that got in my craw. It was one thing that made me practice even harder and work even harder. And that was sitting on the bench, or even not getting picked up on the playground. Who wants to sit on the bench? Who just wants to show up at the game and dress up real nice and have on nice shoes and nice shorts and a nice jersey, but you never get to play in the game? I don't know too many people that's got some competitive nature down on the inside. I don't know too many people that want to win, that's okay with just sitting on the bench. Nobody wants to just ride the bench, and God is calling us. He's calling preachers and pastors to get off the bench. He's calling deacons to get off of the bench. He's calling lay members to get off the bench. I know that we're in the middle of a pandemic. I understand, y'all. And we should take the necessary precautions in the middle of this pandemic. But we should also be willing at some point to rise up and not back down. If we're going to continue to do the work, beloved, prayer is the protocol. Yes, it is the foundation. Posting up is necessary. An assembly of people and a team of people. Look, if you don't have people on your team, if you don't have some people on your team at this point that's ride or die, if you don't have some people on your team that will tell you the truth about yourself, if you don't have some people on your team at this point that really, they don't want nothing from you, but they want the very best for you, if you don't have what I call a team of spiritual advisors, a board of spiritual advisors, people that give it to you straight, uncut, raw, so that you can get better, please don't surround yourself with a bunch of yes men. Please don't surround yourself with a bunch of people that tell you what you want to hear as opposed to what you need to hear. Come into my white brothers and sisters. There's some things that you need to hear. You need to hear that racism is real. You need to hear that you walk in privilege. You need to hear that not all people are treated the same. You need to hear those things. And we need to feel those things. We need to have those conversations if we're going to continue this work. My worry is that the energy and effort is going to turn off. My worry is that we're going to abandon the work that God has called us to do. But if the priest will go first, if we will keep the message out, if we will talk about it on Sundays and on Wednesdays, if we will keep feeding this thing, feeding this movement, if we will sacrifice and open up our doors to our churches and to our young people and work on creating programs that are going to help young people and help those in less fortunate situations and underserved communities. If we will do the heavy lifting, then all of our strength will be able to endure. The scripture says that their strength started to give out, and every now and then along this journey, understand that you will get tired. All of us get to a point that we get tired. It is heavy lifting. Make no mistake about it. It requires a lot. It requires putting in the work. And the Bible says that they say it's just too much, that our strength is given out, that it's too much rubble. And the more we build and the more we clear out, it seems like the more falls into the space that we just cleared out. I want you to know this evening, be not dismayed. Whatever be tied, God will take care of you. If you just keep moving a little bit at a time, if you just keep chipping away at this thing, just a little bit at a time, if you just keep putting in some effort a little bit at a time, if you just keep showing up every day and just doing a little bit every single time, you will get to a point that the wall comes up in a short amount of time. We have been blessed with the awesome opportunity to do this work. And trust me, it is a privilege to be able to do this work. It's a privilege to be able to live in the times that we're living in now. It's a privilege to be able to see God work miracles through pandemics. It's a privilege to be able to live in times like these. I know sometimes it seems tough, but God has blessed this generation at this time to do this heavy lifting and to do this work. Look, you got to have an attitude of gratitude, and you got to say to yourself when you get tired that, God, I understand and I thank you. I praise you because I get to do this. I don't have to do this. You miss your shout right there. You need to say, God, thank you for the work that you've entrusted me with, that you have said to me that you trust me with this heavy lifting. You said to me, God, that you trust me, God, with your word. You trust me with your people. You trust me to do this work. You trust me, God, not to fail you. You trust me, God, to hold on in tough times. It's a privilege. We get to do this. We don't have to do this. But here's the thing. If we don't do the work, God will use somebody else. God will use whomever he needs to get his work done. So, beloved, tonight, as I close this book, broadcast, I want you to know it's a privilege and an honor to be living in the times that we are now. I know it's tough. I know it's rough. I know it's difficult, but I need you to know during this Bible study that Nehemiah didn't have to do this work. He got to do this work because he cared, because there was a calling on the inside of him, because he had an assignment. You have an assignment. God wants you to get to your work and to do your little part in this movement. God wants you to just do the little bit that he's called you to do. Just hold up your corner. Just do your part. And I guarantee you, at the end of the day, if we all do our part, then we will effectively see something done that has never been done before. And the Bible says in 52 days, the wall started to come up. The enemy didn't believe that they could do it. The enemy just could not perceive that they could do it. The enemy threw all kind of opposition at them while they were doing it. But in 52 days, in short order, the wall started to come back up. And I'm telling you, if we bind together, if we come together, if we don't lose our focus, if we stay the course and not allow this to fade, in short time, we'll see the change start to happen. A change is going to come, but we got to do the work. So, beloved, keep on praying and make sure that as you pray, you post if necessary. Keep on calling on the name of the Lord, and God will make a way somehow. Get your team right in 2020. I know it's been a rough year, but get your team right in 2020. There's going to be some opportunity that comes through here, and God is saying, don't you get ready. I need you to stay ready. Don't you be preparing, because opportunity does not necessarily knock. Sometimes opportunity kicks in your door, and if you're not ready to receive it, if you're not in a place where you can harness it, where you can capture it and take advantage of it, you're going to miss your moment. Look, don't goal set just to get there. Goal set to win it. Don't goal set just to get the protest started. Goal set to win the laws, to win the change in our land. Assemble your team. Get your team together. And we as clergy, I vow to you, us as clergy, we hear and we see, and we're going to start going first. We're going to start leading the way, because God has put on the inside of so many of my fellow co-laborers in the gospel that no longer do many of us even care about what anybody says or thinks. You see the openness on Facebook, on Instagram, and Twitter that men and women of God are coming out and saying, you know what? Enough is enough. We will not be used as props for a photo op. We will not be used as props for a mini motion picture. We don't just want to be associated with power or sitting next to power or at the table with power. No, we are going to take the power and use it in a way that God has called us to use it. In order for this work to keep going, you got to pray. You got to get the people. You got to post up as necessary. And we as the priests, we have to go first. I pray this message, this teaching has blessed your heart. I pray, God, I pray that it has emptied and poured into your spirit. I pray that it moves you to stay the course. I'm not going to let it go, y'all. If you're looking for something different, you'll just have to go somewhere else. But for the meantime and in between time, we have to keep this thing going. We got to keep the fire stoked, and we got to keep the purpose going. We got to keep ourselves on the straight and narrow and headed to our promised land. God has saying that the whole land is ours to take, all of it. He said it's our season, it's our time to take back everything that the enemy stole from us. May the Lord God bless you real good.